And again, because of extreme popular demand, we're now bringing you back the lecture of Doctora Gisela Sarmiento.
Addressing weight regain, looking for sustainable options for weight loss. I would like to thank Novo Nordisk Pharmaceutical Philippines for letting me lecture this particular topic for the PAAMI 8th Annual Convention. The objective of this lecture is to discuss obesity as a disease and impact to the Filipinas, mechanisms behind weight regain among people with obesity, liraglutide as an option in weight regain prevention. Obesity is no longer seen as a simple lifestyle choice. Global organizations agree that obesity is a chronic medical illness. Thus, it fulfills the definition of an ailment or disease. It impairs functioning, it brings about a lot of signs and symptoms, and it causes a lot of harms and morbidities and comorbidities. To put it into perspective, obesity can be viewed as the root of a lot of diseases, mainly metabolic, mechanical, and mental. For metabolic, there's asthma, there's also non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, gallstones, there's infertility, there's an entire gamut of your cerebrovascular diseases and its risk factors, such as stroke, dyslipidemia, there's also hypertension, coronary artery disease, congestive heart failure, and other things. There's also type 2 diabetes, there's thrombosis, and can even lead to death. There's also carcinoma. For the mechanical aspect, there is physical functioning, wherein there's incontinence, arthrosis, sleep apnea, and chronic back pain. As to mental, there's depression and anxiety. All of this precludes that obesity is also a major risk factor to increase in this COVID-19 times and pandemic. What we know so far is that obesity increases the risk of severe illnesses amongst patients with COVID-19. It also triples the risk of hospitalizations due to the COVID-19 virus. It also linked to impaired immune functions. There's also a decrease of the lung capacity and, of course, the reserve, and can make ventilation more difficult. A BMI increase, or as the BMI increases, there's a risk for death from the COVID illnesses. Studies have also demonstrated that obesity may be linked to lower vaccine responses for a lot of immune illnesses or immune responses and diseases such as influenza, hepatitis B, and tetanus. It's a global pandemic. Almost 650 million people is widely affected globally. And of course, in the Philippines, there's about 37.2 afflicted, wherein about 33.9 million Filipinos are affected out of the 107 population that we have. So obesity is a disease. 4 out of 10 Filipinos are obese or overweight. People with obesity are clustered in urban areas. There's more than 39.9% on the National Capital Region. There's 30.1% on Cebu and Central Visayas, and about 33% in Davao and Northern Mindanao. Why? Because there's higher stress levels. There's easier access to fast foods, more Western diet, lack of exercise, medications, genetics, stress, and the entire gamut of obesity increasing in the country. On Philippines lockdown, there's an unhealthy lifestyle that place Filipinos at higher obesity and COVID-19 risk. So what should be done? Eating a healthy diet, being active, getting enough sleep, and coping with stress. However, the loss or lack of income contributes to inability to acquire and provide nutritious food. Stress and boredom contributes to increase to food intake. And there's limitation in mobility, preventing the adequate exercise and access to food. For most individuals, lifestyle modification is the first choice of treatment. Nutritionists would say that diet plus exercise would be the key. A reduction of daily caloric intake by 500 kilocal per day and a 20 to 30 minutes of mild to moderate intensity exercise per day is paramount. These are actually the primary treatment options for weight loss for patients with obesity. However, more often than not, weight regain follows after every intervention. In this particular slide, we can see here the differing weight changes patterns for diets of different intensities. A very low-calorie diet with behavior therapy may provide rapid initial weight loss that exceeds the weight loss achieved with a very low-calorie or modified diet plus behavioral therapy. However, the benefits disappear over the long term, and by 5 years post-intervention, there is little difference between the diet types, with mean weight change back to the baseline level for all diets. Since obesity is a complex and multifactorial illness, as with energy intake, expenditures, it has long been misunderstood, trivialized, and stigmatized as a simple lifestyle issue that can be effectively addressed by the mantra of eat less, move more. This simplistic view of obesity disregards both the lived experience of persons with obesity, as well as the vast body of scientific evidence showing that, like other chronic diseases, obesity is rather heterogeneous condition, resulting from the complex interaction of a multitude of socio-psychobiological factors that promote excessive weight gain and ultimately impair the health of individuals. Most importantly, once established, powerful neurohormonal factors effectively defend our bodies against weight loss, thereby often making obesity a lifelong problem, where weight regain or relapse is a rule rather than expectation. So when there is an imbalance between energy intake and energy expenditure, obesity under normal circumstances, there's long-term energy balance that is centrally regulated by the brain, receiving peripheral input from the adipose tissue, the pancreas, and the gut on energy stores and nutritional state via neural and endocrinologic pathways. The imbalance is energy intake and expenditure can result from changes in these peripheral signals, as well as from genetic predisposition and the impact of medications. Environmental, societal, psychological factors, together with the pleasure we derive from the food, which are the hedonic factors that we take care of, can also influence energy balance, which in turn can lead to weight gain. Although it is well established that obesity is a primary driver for many chronic illnesses such as cancer, heart disease, and diabetes, obesity is also a chronic disease in itself. The brain controls eating behavior and appetite on three levels. There's homeostatic eating, there's hedonic eating, and there's executive function. Homeostatic eating is eating based on hunger. This is mainly under hypothalamic control. It is a balance between feelings of satiety and hunger. Your satiety is mediated by your receptor GLP-1, your peptide double Y, oxyntomodulin, your pancreatic polypeptide, and your amylin. And that hunger is mediated by ghrelin. Now, your hedonic eating, this is eating based on pleasure. There is mainly under mesolimbic control. This is mediated by feelings of wanting or liking to eat. A want to eat is mediated by dopamine. This is a hormone implicated in a reward behavior system. This is actually responsible for cravings that we may have, like, for an example, when we crave for milk tea in the afternoon after a day's work. Now, as opposed to liking, this is to eat associated with pleasure derived from eating. And this is mediated through the opioid and cannabinoid receptors. This is responsible for our preferences in the food that we eat, and can really explain why we prefer certain restaurants or shops to buy this food. Now, your third function is your executive function. This is the decision to eat mediated primarily by the prefrontal cortex. This region of the brain is the site of action for behavioral interventions, which we can use to control whether we give in to the impulse or to eat dictated by the other regulators for appetite. Long-term weight loss is challenging. There is a Nike effect that we know of. That is the problem with weight regain. Based on meta-analysis, weight regain is not necessarily the patient's fault. It is without a doubt that some form of weight loss can be achieved, however, universally, that we can be noted that after any intervention, weight regain is sure to follow. The reason behind this is that the body adapts to any form of weight loss. In a primal survival mechanism, the body thinks that the patient is trying to lose weight This is starvation. Hence, it adjusts its hunger and satiety hormones. It increases all of these factors. It decreases the satiety hormones, as well as reduces its energy expenditure, using less amount of energy for daily processes, to ensure that whatever weight that is lost is regained by the person. While this is usually becoming the source of frustration and depression among patients that is trying to lose weight, wherein they feel that it's their fault on why they are regaining weight, when in fact it is the body counteracting whatever intervention that is being done in order to regain weight. The metabolic adaptation makes maintaining weight loss so challenging. A systematic view or review of obesity studies where participants successfully lost weight demonstrated a trend of weight regain towards baseline during follow-up, suggesting that weight loss is difficult to maintain over time for a majority of participants. Metabolic adaptation is a physiological process characterized by changes in the levels of appetite-regulating hormones and a decrease in energy expenditure. When weight is lost, the energy expenditure associated with the resting metabolic rate and the metabolic rate with activity decreases because less work must be done to maintain homeostasis or to move the body. Liraglutide 3.0 milligram reduces food intake, resulting into weight loss. Like the natural GLP-1 or the glucagon-like peptide 1, liraglutide activates specific areas in the brain involved in the regulation of appetite and food intake. This reduces hunger and increases the fullness, the satiety, making people eat less food. There's a trial design we call the scale maintenance system, wherein weight maintenance with liraglutide 3.0 after the LCD-induced weight loss was studied. Here we can see the trial design, wherein it was a 56-week randomized double-blind placebo-controlled multicenter study. This trial was designed to investigate the potential of liraglutide 3.0 milligram to maintain prior diet and exercise-induced weight loss in adults with obesity or BMI of more than 30 kilograms, or with overweight BMI of more than 27 kilogram with comorbidities. Participants were first treated with a low-calorie diet and encouraged to undertake 150 minutes of physical activity per week during a variable length run in period of between 4 and 12 weeks. The participants achieving more than 5% weight loss with this run in period were then randomized to receive either liraglutide 3.0 or placebo for 56 weeks. All individuals received 500 kilocalorie per day, deficit diet and exercise programs, and after 56 weeks, there was a 12-week drug follow-up period. Three co-primary endpoints were assessed hierarchically at the 56 weeks: mean percentage change in fasting body weight from the time of randomization, the proportion of patients maintaining more than 5% decrease in weight achieved during the run-in, and the proportion of patients who lost an additional more than 5% of their fasting body weight after randomization. Now, this slide would show liraglutide providing further weight loss following a low-calorie diet and physical activity. If you notice on this slide, the slide shows that for the first of the three co-primary endpoints, mean percentage change in body weight was discussed. During the run-in period lasting up to 12 weeks, mean weight loss of 6% was achieved in both groups. The weight profiles of the two groups diverged after randomization to liraglutide 3.0 milligram or placebo. At week 56, body weight had continued to decrease in the liraglutide 3.0 milligram group, with an additional mean weight loss of 6.2% over the treatment period. By comparison, body weight was maintained in the placebo group but did not decrease. During the treatment follow-up period, both treatment groups gained weight. This particular slide, wherein the left graph shows proportion of individuals maintaining the weight loss achieved during the run-in period in the two groups, 81% treated with liraglutide 3.0 achieved this compared with 49% in the placebo group. Weight regain was also analyzed, as shown in the graph on the right, and significantly fewer individuals in the liraglutide 3.0 milligram group gained more than 5% of their randomization body weight compared with placebo. Now, this slide is a third co-primary endpoint related to the proportion of individuals who lost 5% or more of their body weight after randomization. That is in addition to the weight loss during the run-in phase. Again, this is significantly favored liraglutide 3.0 mg over placebo. More than four times as many patients treated with liraglutide has achieved weight loss of more than 10% after randomization compared with placebo. So, with this in mind, liraglutide and all of these results, Saxenda 3.0 mg, is the first and only Philippine FDA-approved weight loss medicine in a flex-touch pen that helps you lose weight and keep them off on a sustainable manner. It's a self-injectable flex pen wherein you can put it in your upper arm or the abdomen or the thigh. It's available as a pack of three pens per box. We start the patient on week one to do 0.6 milligram using a novel fine 4 millimeter needle, and that is achieved or that is being done for 7 days, followed by increasing titration of 1.2 milligram for the second week. After 7 days, another 1.8 milligram increase, and on the fourth week, 2.4 milligram. Week five onwards, it's 3.0 milligram therapeutic maintenance dose. This is how I manage some of the obese patients or some of the patients that I had in time of COVID. Now, you know for a fact that during COVID, there's so much or plenty of food deliveries and people are having a hard time losing weight. This is a case of a 39-year-old male who is 5'9", with a BMI of 28, which is overweight, before of 190 pounds, after which liraglutide 168 pounds. He's an IT man with a bronchial asthma, alcoholic drinker, taking his meals twice a day, complete food groups with no restrictions. He's metabolically actually moderately active, and he does about 2 exercises in a week. He has blood pressure of 150 over 100 before liraglutide baseline, and then seemingly it dropped up to 110 over 90 after or during the liraglutide treatment. His laboratories have precluded him with dyslipidemia before liraglutide. How severe is the patient's obesity? He is really stressed out from work, with big belly on some quadrants, extra lab handles. He has hypercholesterolemia and is hypertensive with no medications by preference. His weight goals is to at least 5% weight loss every 6 to 5 weeks and 10% weight loss after 20 weeks and beyond, with this comorbidities to note for. The options considered for the treatment approach for these patients is that he doesn't want any medications for hypertension and hypercholesterolemia. He wanted his own natural way. So the liraglutide decision is due to the patient. Right timing, not to take any maintenance or medicine. Right timing of the Saxenda introduction in the Philippines and a more holistic approach that is weight management along with improvements on comorbidities that is more target specific. Look at these photos. His photos of 190 pounds before and with a better contouring of his abdominal areas, upper, mid, and lower, which is 168 pounds after. Lessened love handles after about four to eight weeks of using liraglutide, and on the sides with a better contour of his abs. This is a case of a 27-year-old female, which is about 9 months postpartum. She's 5'2", BMI is upper limit, near overweight, before liraglutide, 134 pounds. She's a medical representative. She has gravity 1, para 1, a social drinker, a smoker before, during college days. She eats 2 times a day with complete food groups and no restrictions. She exercises 2 times a week with a normal blood pressure, and laboratory findings were essentially normal. How severe is the patient's obesity? Actually, she only has extra big belly on some abdominal quadrants, and she also has a lot of lab handles. The weight goal is a 5% weight loss every 6 to 8 weeks with no comorbidities. Patient is just postpartum and would want to eliminate flabby abdomen and lab handles. Right timing of the Saxenda introduction in the Philippines and more holistic approach that is weight management along with better health that's more target specific. This has a very, very good result, decreasing the lab handles as well from the sides as compared also on the frontal view. And the patient was very, very happy with the results, from 134 down to 122 pounds in just a matter of 8 weeks. Now, this is an interesting case, a 45-year-old female physician, 5'3 in height, a weight of 160 pounds or 73 kilograms, level 1 overweight. She is Gravita 1, Para 1, and from which a medical history, she has myoma, polyps, endometriosis, and palpitations when deprived of sleep. A non-smoker, non-alcoholic. She mainly eats 2 meals in a day, about 5 times per day of plenty sweets. No restrictions on carbohydrates. She doesn't eat rice. And actually, because it's not by choice, she's not really into rice eating. Her activity behavior is no exercise at all for the past 5 years. So she's not dieting. Her blood pressure is about 130 over 90. She is not actually active. Her laboratories are a bit of an increase of the liver enzymes and a bit of the increase of the lipid enzymes as well. How severe is the patient's obesity? Patient was ectomorph with a usual body weight of 45 kilogram before and then increasing into 56 kilogram after giving birth in 2003, which was maintained until 39 years of age, but gained massive weight starting 39 years old until present, reaching to 73 kilos. Now her BMI level 1 is overweight. What are the treatment goals for this patient? The patient hopes to lose weight of about 40 pounds that would be ideal for her BMI, address slowly her comorbidities of hyperlipidemia and fatty liver, maintain the normal blood pressure, get back to mesomorph body physique shape, if not ectomorph. Patient is taking statins once per day and liver supplements daily and liraglutide 3 milligrams daily. So what is the best treatment approach for this patient? Should be an inclination to exercise, the manage eating habits, lower down on sweets and carbohydrates, and of course, so as to be able to address the comorbidities. This patient is actually me. So I was this particular photo. So this was 73 kilograms or 160 pounds. And I started using Saxenda or liraglutide in April 2020 and lost 20 pounds down or 9 kilograms down in just a matter of about 6 to 8 weeks or 6 months journey, and now at present at 64 kilogram or 141 pounds. So overall, on our patient outcome, how effective was the patient's treatment and follow-up? Initial goal was achieved. Body physique result was salutary, especially from the plavy areas and cellulites decrease, loosened compact and edematous fat areas, addressing the hyperlipidemia and diastolic hypertension. What were the challenges that we met for the patients within liraglutide? Cost, especially when it becomes 3.0 milligrams daily, side effects are not the same from one patient to another, which served also as an advantage. Some patients would forget the injection time, morning versus nighttime administration. So we would say that it's better to give it on a particular timely method. So what will be the outcome if observed for patients while on liraglutide? Results are for real, especially if patients adhere to the protocol. It's fast, sustainable, and dependable. Any safety concerns during the titration phase of treatments? How should we address this? Injection and same site may produce wheal formation or some injection site irritations and slowly become cystic or bullous. Make sure to observe aseptic technique. Topicals, anti-infectives, and anti-inflammatory may be helpful, and we can also do cold compress and warm compress. So as a physician, what has been the overall value of using liraglutide for this patients? There's safety to note for sustainable manner of losing weight, slowly but surely, dependable, worry-free, medical evidence-based studies and multifidus results, and no yo-yo results. In summary, obesity is a chronic medical disease and a global pandemic. 4 out of 10 Filipinos are either overweight or obese. Lifestyle modification is the primary intervention for patients with obesity. However, most people will experience weight regain within 2 years. The brain is responsible for maintaining the weight set point, and metabolic adaptations come into play in the face of weight loss that promotes weight regain. Liraglutide is a centrally acting drug which affects the centers of the brain involved in hunger and satiety, resulting into weight loss. The scale maintenance trial has shown that liraglutide on top of diet and exercise can prevent weight regain, providing an additional 6.2% weight loss compared to placebo. With that, I thank you very much for joining me in this lecture.